level, at the organisational level, and then finally at the national and international level. And for each one, I will outline a few of the major trends, and then talk a little bit about what Oman, what the GCC states, and what other states more generally are doing in response to these threats. So to start with, the individual level, right? And maybe you're, this is the people in the room, this is the most important, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone has their device so close to them. You wake up in the morning, and what's the first thing you reach for? Don't ask that question. But in the GCC, at least, lots of other people have multiple devices. These things have penetrated our lives so innately that we really rely on them for absolutely everything. And if you try and think about life not just without your device, but without any kind of internet application, this is a change of a magnitude that few generations have seen before. So we are really living through something very unique. And as part of that, it's massively beneficial, right? We see the advantages day in and day out. And with those advantages do come some risks, right? The fact that we rely so much on our devices, the fact that we give so much information to them and put through them, means that information changes and information flows change in ways that are often beyond our control. If we suddenly lose access to our data, if we lose access to the services we rely on day in and day out, or even if our data is misused by companies or governments that we rely on, then that is a really severe consequence for everyone. So to start with, cybersecurity is a threat at the individual level. And while we may talk a lot about organizations and governments and these very abstract concepts, I'd always like to bring it down to the individual impact of digital insecurity. And that's why we work to improve security in that way. What is the main response here? Now, a couple of different things. First of all, cybersecurity awareness is kind of number one. If you are more aware of what you are doing with your data, with your devices, or the kinds of risks you could be vulnerable to, then you are more likely to act in a cautious, sensible, and prepared way. And we all do this instinctively offline. Right? Just think about where you might walk, where you might travel, how you might drive in different conditions, right? If it's snow on the roads, not a very relevant example, or any other kind of weather event, you're going to drive very differently, right? You do this without really thinking about it. And online, we don't necessarily have those individual learned behaviors that we need to cultivate to be secure online. So the first thing is just to be very aware, to develop your awareness and that instinct for what is and isn't secure online. I'll move up to the second level now. And this is the organizational level. So we as individuals rely on organizations for digital provision of services and our security. But organizations are at risk from a wide range of cyber threats, right? Ranging from things such as hacktivists or cyber criminals, so motivated by political issues or motivated by illegitimate profit, to much more high-level threats, things like APTs or advanced persistent threats, usually associated with state-sponsored actors. Now, I'm not differentiating between public sector or private sector organizations, often because, at least at the cyber criminal level, these threats are looking for a way in. Like they might, if it's especially a ransomware gang, they are looking to extort, to get people to pay money, and they don't really care if you're a government or a business entity, as long as you have the cash. The world looks very different from a cyber criminal, right? You see, as we said, opportunities everywhere, not the kind of opportunities people want to take, but they are very driven by weaknesses in or expansion of what we call the attack surface. So for organizations, as they move online, as they engage more digitally, their attack surface increases, and there are more points of entry for malicious actors, or cyber threats to exploit. And what is the main solution here? Well, in most theories of organizational behavior, you have a hard and a soft route, a regulatory, a legal route to enforce certain kinds of behaviors, making sure organizations implement cybersecurity procedures. But on the other hand, you have to have the educational element as well. and an internal rationale for doing cybersecurity right. And the argument here is not just that you should comply with, as in Oman's case, the many cybersecurity laws and regulations that are out there, but also because it makes good business sense to do so. And that's the organizational level. So we have a few different rationales for that. And then finally, looking at states, Benjamin's question started with the fact that Oman has moved very quickly in the cybersecurity policy space from what was a very low base for pretty much all states to very quickly implementing and producing a range of policies that took it up its international index, its international ranking. And states now need to move not just beyond educating their citizens for cybersecurity awareness, not just helping organizations and, where necessary, enforcing cybersecurity regulation, but also they need to look internationally at their diplomatic relations. Cybersecurity is now a key part of many diplomatic relations. Areas of geopolitical tension have cybersecurity elements, and so states are now beginning to integrate into the most core parts of their function, their ability to act and influence on the world stage. I think I'll stop there, and then hand over. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, James. Fascinating overview. Sarah, I'm curious how, from your perspective, leading cyber defense at one of the largest oil and gas companies in Oman, in the region at large too, how that calculus changes how you think about cybersecurity threats, trends, really anything you're noticing, and if you could comment on such things from your perspective in operational technology.
Thank you very much. I'm very valid as an Oman, like lots of countries in the Middle East rely long on critical infrastructure. And when we talk about critical infrastructure, we mean energy sector, electricity, power, medical, education, where these sectors, it's like part of our day-to-day, as James just started. When we talk about individual, always we think, for example, every day when I wake up, I need water, I need energy for my car, like diesel to drive from point A to point B to work and so on. So if they stop, definitely the impact can be severe and catastrophic. So here when we talk about operational technology, what are the systems that are used to control those critical infrastructure? So it's a bit challenging where I work in cyber defense because we are not just controlling IT environment. Or the worst case scenario of an environment gets hit with by a ransomware attack or a computer system that, for example, disabled, and of course, availability is not there. But think about the loss of money for a country that where its critical infrastructure and operation systems are unavailable, their safety systems are unavailable. Think about the latest major attack we had in critical infrastructure, like everyone started focusing on it and even investing in critical infrastructure and operational technology. It's mainly started, I can say, by Stuxnet in 2010. The focus on cybersecurity and operational technology was really very limited. It was most of the investments we spent in OT. But after Stuxnet, people realized working in the field in cybersecurity is now there are sophisticated attacks that be focused for months and years to disable the critical infrastructure, and where nuclear bomb dams for Iran that crashed, and the whole thing started by attacking Windows systems, and the attack was so severe people started rethinking the whole thing. Now we are in the Middle East, we are in Oman. Yes. We need to focus our investment, even our money, our focus, our efforts, not just to protect our IT environment, but also the OT, which is operational technology. Who are not aware about OT? It's mainly the control systems to control those operations. For example, if you heard about the SCADA networks, the supervisor control network, it's like here when the attack happened, the attack, it's not just disabling the operations, it can lead to attacking even the safety systems. That's the safety system, we are talking about people, by fatalities, where HSC, if anyone working in critical infrastructure, always we say HSC, health, safety, environment is our top priority. So here it's like we feel the responsibility is very high. We feel the heat when it comes if there is any emerging cyber threats or challenges. And nowadays, post-COVID, I think not just in Oman, not just in Middle East, it's globally, everyone feel the drastic change in our life. Now we have lots of, we have seen and observing the number of cyber attacks and threats attacking the I can see everyone, but even in Middle East, we have seen the increase large. It's double and triple the number of events that we used to see pre-COVID. So as the reason, as Jim said, digitalization, everyone digital, it's like everything online, education is online. We are doing all our services, even governmental services online. We really rely a lot on digital, and this is the core reason why it is increasingly soft, having a big heat and challenges. So yes, now I think it's the time for even to have a strategic approach at the national level, where we really invest a lot from budget perspective, from even the strategic approach, investing in our workforce resources to strengthen our capability. And I feel, alhamdulillah, we are in the right track.
Great. Thank you so much. Speaking of strategically thinking about these things and meeting this challenge, this challenge today, Haitham, I'm curious, from your perspective as someone who's worked extensively both in the public and private sector, how both public sector entities, but also small, medium, large enterprises in the private sector in Oman can meet these challenges and can meet these challenges on those different levels that James and Sarah are indicating, both in terms of IT cybersecurity and OT cybersecurity, with a multilingual and diverse workforce, you know.
Sure. Now, when we talk about the cybersecurity initiatives here in Oman, well, we started a bit earlier. That's why we ranked globally second and third. Why? Because as a readiness in the region, we have taken that lead, and maybe James was with us from the beginning. We have become a regional cybersecurity center by ITU. And we are not here only to talk about enabling cybersecurity in Oman, but actually to elevate the whole region. That's why we see Saudi Arabia, Emirates are spending much more now because they realize the value in enhancing their cybersecurity, because again, the services will be enhanced. Now, as Sarah also indicated, we have seen a growth in number of attacks. Why? Because the region, geopolitically, we have become on the news everywhere, basically. So
why do you think that?
I think it's a hot topic. A lot of things happen in the Middle East. And now we know the fifth army is on, the sixth army is the cyber army, right? So if you want to attack a country now, you might do a lot of damage cyberly than actually sending a missile or something. Mm. So we have moved to cyber wars. And James had indicated a very important aspect that here in Oman, we value our diplomatic relations. That's why now a new terminology that surfaces cyber diplomacy. And I believe we in Oman, we are taking a lead because we are being natural. Everybody comes to us to solve problems. Therefore, cyber diplomacy has become natural to second to us. Now, we are in the region, we are peacemakers. We try to elevate peace. Therefore, Oman also is subject to a lot of attacks. Why? Because every hacker in there, he wants to make a dent, right? He wants to make a name for himself. He says, hey, I hacked a country X. I hacked Oman, for example. And then he can make a dent in the cybersecurity industry saying that I took honor in hacking so-and-so. Now, again, the Middle East is a hot topic. What we have the most, I mean, Sara works there, PDO, right? We have petrol. Now, if you want to really make a dent as a hacker, you want to target the biggest thing you have, oil and rigs and electronic energy sector, transportation sector. If they could successfully hack, they can make a name for themselves. Tomorrow they can establish a company or so on, and then they capitalize on their attack. Therefore, we have encouraged also private sector, not only governmental, to actually enhance their security, because as a service, again, they will be producing more. We say that security as an enabler, because most people think if I apply more security, I'm restricting data, I'm restricting progress, right? But if you look at it from a different perspective, having a secure system, like in COVID, most people have moved online very fast because they have the infrastructure to actually move. The others suffered a little bit because their infrastructure was never ready to take online working or online trading very fast. And as I say, when COVID came, it actually was a learning curve. We have learned how to be agile, and to be perfectly agile, you have to have security. Because again, you cannot just go and offer services online without being secure, because a lot of people will take a shot at you. And that's what happens online. And I think we have moved very fast at the beginning, and we have elevated the countries around us. And that's why we see a lot of countries around, especially in the Middle East now, they see the value that Oman have took the initiatives, we became the center here again, and now they're spending more in cybersecurity, which everybody is supposed to have a fixed budget on their systems for security. But unfortunately, small businesses, they cannot afford security. So what they do, they just wing it. Rigidly, I have seen small companies say, what can I do? If I go to managed service, they are very expensive. If I want to hire a cybersecurity expert, he is very expensive. And again, if I hired him, he will demand a lot of security tools, which I cannot afford. He will demand a team, which again, as a small business, I cannot afford. So what the solution? And we looked at this and we said, we should have managed services for security, small to business entrepreneurships, and we should have like a support package for those people.
Mm.
But again, if we look at it, now there are services online. Now you can open your own store within 15 to 20 minutes, secure store, secure online payments. You don't have to take the whole lot in-house. You don't have to hire people there. You can go and buy the services online. And we will encourage people to buy it, but with a reputable data. Now again, you need to focus that if you want to deal with Oman, for example, data, you have to talk about data sovereignty. Again, it has to be hosted in Oman, with a local company, your data is not exposed to the outside world. So there are a couple of challenges, but we are looking at it in different perspective. As Jim said, now we start with individuals, we educated them, we had a lot of campaigns starting 2009, 2010. We talked a lot about blackmailing because it became a very serious issue. We talked about ransomware, and we have made a lot of national and international campaigns. Actually, we helped countries as well to capitalize on what we have done. We shared all our resources with them. And then we move to companies where ransomware have seen a huge strike globally. I mean, you have heard the news, I don't know, but in IT world, I mean, finally, this is one of the infrastructures for the
Lockbit,
yeah?
Yeah.
And I made a comment saying what happened to the wallets they were receiving money at, so we needed to know also about where the money is going. But there are global forces, and we can only work together to beat such attackers and hackers around the globe. I think I took a lot of my time. Let's move to the other question.
No, please. For those of you who don't know, Lockbit is a ransomware collective based in the former Soviet Union. But Connor, to move to you, my friend. You know, we've been talking a lot about high-level observations in terms of educational initiatives, regulations, what are the trends at different levels in terms of cybersecurity in different environments, but perhaps to the benefit of all of us here, you are kind of focusing on, if you will, it sounds cliche, but the front lines of cybersecurity in your work as a cybersecurity consultant and a penetration tester. And I'm curious to hear from you in terms of what are some of the weaknesses, but also opportunities for improvements for different enterprises in Oman? How are they approaching cybersecurity, and what are ways they can improve some of the problems you're seeing as someone who's directly working with them on this?
Yeah, I mean, I think like the others said, cyber awareness is probably the biggest issue in Oman, both at the individual level, organizational and government level. Quite often companies don't know that they're going to be targeted, so therefore they don't have a budget for security and they do basically nothing about it. So some examples would be, I did a pen test I think about a year ago, and I came across unpatched systems from 2005. which is, yeah. It was, so usually, you know, if a system hasn't been patched for a few months, you know, we'd say that's bad. But, you know, this is talking about decades. And even on the policy side as well, I did a policy review for a company, and the first policy was refer to policy XYZ, and that policy said ask the head of IT what to do. I think with Oman, I think they Oman skipped a generation of technological development, because when I was a kid in the UK, for example, you know, I was there when Facebook first came around, and everyone was very cautious about what to post on there. And I think with the new generation coming into Oman, they've gone straight into, you know, like Facebook, for example, posting as much as possible. And I think that mentality has also spread to the companies as well. I don't think anyone ever thinks they're going to be attacked. I think that's one of their biggest threats over here.
Why do you think that is?
So I think because it's only, like Hay from said, it's only recently that Oman's been on the news. So I think a lot of people thought they could go under the radar. And as well with Oman being a very friendly nation, I think that as well, as people would say, why would they attack us? What have we done to them? I think that's quite a common finding I've come across.
Thank you. So a follow-up question related to that. Given that PEO in Oman, based on conversations I've had with different professionals in the field over the past few months, it in many ways is considered almost a paragon of cybersecurity excellence, in that it's doing a lot of things right, and a lot of companies, and at least in the oil and gas field, base their approach to cybersecurity on what PDO is doing. And I'm curious how you approach that issue that Connor's talking about, cyber awareness, cybersecurity education, both in your workforce and just in general, because as far as I'm aware, much of your workforce speaks Arabic, but also English and other languages too, and so when it comes to a multilingual workforce, that must be difficult.
Thank you. I guess Iman from the audience is the right person, because she is heading the awareness stream in the video. But very valid concern. We always say, like, the people should be the first line of defense, and in all cases also they are the weakest link, because there is a social part in it, and social engineering becoming one of the top techniques that hackers do to impersonate, and you have seen lots of scams over WhatsApp, over social media, and how sophisticated it's becoming, and we are very much aware that this should be one of the key focus area, and we should be also like a role model on one. And being working in the energy sector, we do acknowledge that we should be being like a role model for big to medium to small scale of companies here, and how we can promote this cybersecurity culture. So we do have collaboration at energy sector, and even at with all regulators, and even we really believe, and I think people who know video very well, they hear a lot about ICV. This means in-country value. What in-country value we can do for to secure the nation. So there are lots of in-country value initiatives that we have it even in our big strategic goals, and how we can strengthen the cyber security competency at a national level. And there is lots of collaboration with the Cyber Security Academy. People knows Arman very well. They must be heard about it, because this is now like the strategic partner where which is task meeting collaboration with multiple regulators to strengthen the cybersecurity knowledge and competency. Even I worked individually, not just part of video, but individually as part of one of the cybersecurity projects mainly. It's called Cyber Wafa, which is partner with us, but mainly to establish the cybersecurity workforce framework. It's actually lots of huge efforts, multi-year project that we spent. We need to identify what are the cybersecurity paths that we should have, and what are the different
roles
and even the competency that we should build across different proficiency level. Because if we strengthen the workforce because you have rolled it out only for the top key sector in Oman, and now to be rolled for all entities, including governmental entities and small entities in Oman. I feel if we really adhere to that and start strengthening it, at least across the major entities to follow the silo framework implemented, even the job description, the hiring process, everything, even with the, for the cybersecurity professionals, they will be the ambassadors even with their families and the nation.
Great, thank you so much. A question for any panelists who'd like to jump in here. All of you have touched upon in different ways how Oman is digitalizing and technologizing very quickly. And some would say that is coming before security and essentially designs of how to technologize are being implemented without necessarily security being in mind. And with that being said, right, like Oman and its five-year economic plan that was released 2 years ago and also in Vision 2040 mentioned that it's aiming to digitalize a significant portion of its economy, meaning to make sure its economy is able to work digitally instead of only physically, right? And I'm curious from James, if you'd like to answer this, or anyone else too, what are some of the technologies that are becoming more and more and more apparent and used, not only in cybersecurity, but also in terms of threats that companies in the GCC region need to think about, and what are ways to think about dealing with them? And things that come to mind, right, are quantum computing and how that affects cryptography, or chatbots, AI, machine learning, things like this. It's all happening really quickly. Oman's really interested in being a part of this. But cybersecurity is important too, right? So,
yeah, no, it's a great question and a big one as well. Maybe I'll start with the component on security by design, right? Because this is something that you could think about security by design at a technological level, right? Ideally, we would not have to be employing people like Connor, right? Ideally, you'd be
able
to. So, you know, software companies would conduct code reviews, they'd find systems. They find holes in their systems, they patch them before they release them into the wild, right? They would do that because it made business sense to do so. They might do so in critical infrastructure sectors because there's regulation forcing them to do so. But then our world would be a safer place online. That's not the world we live in. Software liability does not exist. And partly for good reason, right? You know, innovation requires quick thinking, it requires creativity, it requires anyone to be able to set up an online shop really quickly. And that kind of vibrancy, that dynamism, doesn't come if you lock everything down. So there's a reason we haven't locked everything down, but the downside is that you get caught. But thinking about security by design, right, that's a technological focus. We can also think about it at a societal way as well. And this is where I think Oman is doing the right thing, where what you have to do is have to think at a state level, how are we going to make our society cyber secure? What kinds of policies need to be in place? What kind of government institutions need to be in place as well? I mean, Oman had for a long time the OSA, which was very good on raising awareness. It moved recently, a couple of years back, to have a cyber defense center, right, that elevates the cybersecurity posture in Oman significantly, moving it in line with others around the world, where they recognize that centralizing cybersecurity decision-making in one organization across government is crucial, whether this is a national cybersecurity center, whether it's a national cybersecurity authority like you might have in Saudi Arabia. The name doesn't matter. The idea is that you are not having one hand of government undermining cybersecurity while the other one is trying to advocate for it. So this kind of security by design at a government level is really crucial. And then moving to the technology piece. Technology changes very fast, right? And cybersecurity is one where the overall dynamic is always going to be one of cat and mouse. The idea is that defenders patch something, they find vulnerabilities and they make sure they don't exist, so attackers move somewhere else. Now, because this is a human relationship between the defender and the attacker, right, they're doing it for a reason, they are able to outwit you, to outsmart you, and so you have to try and outsmart them, that dynamic is not going to go away. So whatever the technology landscape is, whatever the new technologies come in, you will always see this cat and mouse dynamic. You'll see this attempt to evade defenses and then ways to strengthen the defenses. Now, in the short and medium term, this gives advantages to attackers and advantages to defenders. And we can see examples such as cloud provision, for example, right? You have small companies, they don't need to think about security. They don't need to employ a consultant or pay for lots of tools. They just say, fine, right? AWS, Google, other cloud providers are available. You do it for me. I don't need to worry about that. They outsource the risk, and that gives them they can rely on a giant multinational company to secure the systems for them. On the other hand, right, you have these massive data centers, you have whole new flows of data, you have new targets for attackers, you have companies producing cloud applications and then are integrated through open source libraries into these major commercial vendors, then they're not very well secured. Right? So that gives another angle to attackers. So even when you take a relatively well-established technology or change the move to cloud, you see short-term increases in defense and then short-term disadvantages as well. And this will be exactly the same for future technologies when they arrive, so quantum will fit into this bracket as well. I would, just on a side note, a bit of a skeptic about the cryptographic quantum doom that is coming, so I always think because there's a human element, the main thing is all about implementation, right? We know how to do cryptography really well at a mathematical level. That doesn't mean that it happens in practice. So again, cybersecurity is about implementation of software. It's about doing things right and doing things carefully, and that is hard. So that's probably a sufficient answer for that.
Very sufficient, thank you. did anyone else want to answer or add to that before you move? Probably need to move to questions.
In defense of Connor, maybe. I feel bad.
I don't take it personally. I think specifically in Oman, like I said, you know, the jump in the generation of technology. So people are moving to the cloud now, and like James said, you know, they think moving to Microsoft or Google or Amazon, all their problems are going to be solved, purely because there's no patch management. And everyone just thinks it's patch management you have to do at the, you know, the smaller scale of things. And what they don't realize is these clouds have to be configured, and there's weaknesses built into the clouds. You know, it's a huge area, and I think with this technological leap, it's going to bring in new threats, and as new research has been done on this area, you'll see new threats emerging as well, not just from the advanced system threat side, but also even from like individual hackers targeting companies. And that's what I'd add on the cloud side.
Yeah. I just want to top up whatever James and Connor were saying. Now we have new generation of also risks. Everybody's saying move to the cloud. It seems like we're moving to Mars, but actually it's another computer, it's connected to the internet, it's a server, but it's somewhere else. Same rules apply. If they didn't really protect it very well, see, as an individual, let's take this, because everybody needs to benefit from this. I mean, maybe future, who knows, they want to establish a shop online. I'm sharing risk. I'm not expert on security, but I'm expert in selling spare parts. So I want to focus in selling spare parts, marketing for spare parts. So I will go to Amazon or any vendor online, they have a cloud service, and I'll open up shop. Inside, I'm thinking I outsourced my risk, right? I have risk assurance somehow. Now, there is a lot of companies who are benefiting from this as well. They provide services like they want to assure your website, your reputation as well is very important, because now if you know a certain bank got hacked, would you trust that bank with your money? No, right? So you would have risk assurance as well. And I see Connor laughing because he knows a couple of stories. Yeah, so we need to employ Connor again. The reason that I'm saying is now the next generation of threats coming from the same tools that we are using, AI. Now I'm scared more. Do you know why? Because before it needs a full team of professional programmers to make a program and malware that can attack a certain person or leverage a certain vulnerability, a zero-day vulnerability. Nowadays, with the help of an AI, I can create a malware in less than 5 minutes. I don't need the whole team, and I can tweak it. And better yet, I will not even create one. I'll just take an existing one and enhance it, make it rigorous and vigorous, and it can attack a specific IT or an OT in this sense. And that's what we are scared of. Using AI and deep learning, machine learning, and all that to actually get me a vulnerability very fast. Before